Biggie. Ich poppin.
Can y'all see me? I feel like my face is blurred. I feel like this little triangular thing is going too much with my face. Y'all are really loud. Like all the time.
Let me look right here. It's right here. What y'all talking about?
Oh.
Wait, what? Oh, you guys are requesting?
I'll let you come on for a second. I'm getting ready to talk about that hex. But I want to,
Hi.
Hey, Pooh. How y'all doing today?
Good.
What y'all learning about over there today? Y'all
always my birthday.
Oh, it's birthday. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Little Boo, 9 years old today, y'all. Yes. You ready for class tonight?
Yeah.
Y'all, I know y'all already passed the...
Look, I'm the Xbox king.
Ow. What you playing?
Dead by Daylight.
Death by Daylight?
No, Dead by Daylight.
Oh, Dead by Daylight. I don't like that. I don't know if I like that. Was that a zombie game?
No.
No?
It's where you play as a killer or survivor, where you have to do generators to escape.
Oh,
and when you're playing as the killer, you gotta find the people.
Oh, word. What you doing? Who was you?
I was the killer.
Just
you
like
can choose. This is my killer. Hold up. I was playing as him. He's my favorite killer. I love playing him. His name is Wraith.
Where Avery at?
She is asleep, knocked out.
Oh, okay. Well, I gotta get on live and do my little thug fizzle so we can split screen another time, okay, Pooh?
Ooh, I got upgrades.
I bet you did. You enjoy your birthday. Send
okay.
Love.
Thank All you. Right. Bye.
Welcome. Bye. All right, Chuan. Without further motherfucking ado, we on here to talk about that hex post. Because I put that up and I woke up this morning and I swear to you, I had over 50 DMs. So I want to go ahead and talk about it. I want to tell y'all, well, y'all already know, most people who tune into my lives know the backstory. So I'm not going to go too deep into the backstories. I feel like most of y'all already know, right? Most of y'all know what happened, right? That was that job that I told y'all about. I'm covering my little titties because my nipples is hard. Motherfuckers will slice through pennies. But no, I told y'all about that job that oh, hey, Handy Mama, you knew. I've never seen your name before, but welcome. I told about that job I was working with. I was working for, I'll go ahead and say their name because fuck them. I was working for a Greater Washington Psychiatry and Counseling in Greenbelt. And they, let's just say, they were very racist in there. They only hired Black women of a certain tier, like a certain type of Black woman. All of us had at least one child disabled, with some of the women having like multiple children disabled. Yeah, y'all remember that story? Handy doesn't, but I'll give a quick briefing. But the majority of y'all, hey, Baba Alafia, guys, my God, that my godfather is in the chats. Alafia, Baba. But yeah, what was I talking about? Yeah, so I want to go ahead and tell you, like, why I had to go so hard. If you already know the backdrop, then you know, like, why I had to go so hard. Because I physically put in a lot of energy. So remember I told y'all that was that situation where I stayed up. Hey, Samri Boo. Where I stayed up 6 days straight typing out my position statement for the EEO. You know, like, dissecting their evidence, dissecting my evidence, reading about the law. You know, with me having all that Libra in my moon and in my Mars, and then like being a triple Leo in the inside, and then having the nerves to be a Virgo sun, I'm about to be actual and motherfucking factual, bitch. Like, not only am I gonna come, but I'm gonna come correct. Ain't gonna be no motherfucking argument. Ain't gonna be no fucking argument. Oh, Linda! I love you. Hey, girl. Hey, girl. Hey. No, I guess I'll just go ahead and Honey, this is, I didn't even wash my fucking face yet. I be getting on live raw with y'all, but when I get on, when I get on YouTube, I'm gonna try to fix myself up since it's, you know, gonna be some people that's not necessarily a part of my, internet family watching me, so I'll try to fix myself up. I'll try to get cute. Y'all know I can get cute on a nigga, you know what I'm saying? But let's talk about this hex. So, long story short, what had happened particularly with me, because really I was mad about what they did to me. And then the ancestors made it so that the girls that were hired before I was hired, and then, you know, they lost their jobs in real fucked up ways, there was a way I could get in contact with them. Like, they're not just leave me the fuck alone. There was this chick that used to work for, sorry, somebody had just called me and threw me the fuck off. People always want to call when I'm on live. Like, you know, y'all don't be thinking about a nigga no other time. Then I get on here, got something to say. Everybody want to call, you know. Bitch. So anyway, let's get back to it. So what they did to me, particularly to me, this was the story I told y'all in my lives where my son... I do have one son that's cognitively, they say that he's legally, he's cognitively disabled. He's a shaman and he doesn't click with this society or this world, the rules here. So as a spiritual woman, I'm going to see his autism completely differently, but I do understand the rules of the realm. So according to the rules of the realm, he's disabled. Okay. Y'all saw that. Well, if you were on my live before, the one that didn't get saved, y'all saw him divining. So, I mean, being able to meditate with ease. I mean, if I hit end on the fucking call, do not call me back. Don't do that. Like, that's a sure way to piss me off. Because now I feel like you harassing me. That's like being at the door, banging on the door like the popo. Don't fucking do that. Don't call back to back. But anyway... keep having to retell the story or restart the story. So with there's London, and that's the one with autism, and then there's Dallas, my youngest son, my daughter in the middle, but she's never in the mix of the drama. So surprisingly, because she's the Cancer, but my boys, they're Pisces with fire moons. So anyway, Dallas had, on this one particular time, let me shut this down. I'm trying to sum it up, because I don't want to hold y'all too long about it, but it's one of them things where you kind of gotta know certain stuff to understand why I went so hard. You got this white lady who is the office manager, who doesn't have the credentials to be an office manager. I dug into her past. So, like, when I had to do the whole situation of defending myself before the EEO, I had to do like they would normally do in court, and I had to dig into the backgrounds of the people that I was suing so I can, you know, that's the game. Like, one thing I learned from Denzel Washington in these movies he be playing in, I think it was the movie Philadelphia. It's not what you do, is it Training Day? It's not what you do, but it's what you can prove, right? In court is all about the game of exhibits. It's a mind game. It's all about getting people to see it your way and having the exhibits lined up appropriately to where what you have to say and how you make people feel from what you have to say is irrefutable. And they're like, you know what? There's no way this person isn't right. Serve the penalty. So that's the game I was playing, and I like to do it from an honest and truthful standpoint. So, you know, I made sure that I did my research and included what I found into my position statement. And one of the things I found is that, hold on y'all, let me clean this camera off. All right. One of the things that I found is that the office manager that they had bumped up, one, was not qualified. She had a background in pharmacy, but she wasn't qualified to completely run a psychiatric practice. And she had just battled getting her son, like her son had gotten taken from her because she was a opioid addict. And so the baby daddy, she wanted white ladies that was having babies by black men. So the baby daddy, you know, was trying to sue her or whatever and get his son back because he like, she got him, got my son living with this pill popper. And that shit is for public display. So I'm not saying nothing you can't find on Google. I got on case search and I searched every last person I was suing because I sued the whole company. So I was researched everybody. I saw some shit. You got crackheads in the leadership. Pill poppers and shit. You got fraud, all types of fraud, like the head doctor. So there's a head doctor, not a head doctor. There's a, I guess you could say he was a head doctor. There's a doctor, Dr. Sussell, runs the whole, like it's his practice, but he wouldn't have had a practice because I found this out through my digging. He wouldn't have had a practice had Dr. Hafuna not allowed him to sign as like a lower, what's the word I'm looking for? I know y'all don't really understand, like not all of y'all don't really understand like business terms, but say I'm running a business doing readings and Enlightened Chaos or Nausea, she has a credibility, this is just a hypothetical thing, having a credibility issue in the spiritual community as it pertains to her readings, but I don't. So then I'm going to put her up under my name so that my reputation can then cloak hers and then she can go back into business for herself. It was that same type of thing, but just in the medical field. Sussell was about to lose his license because he was already being sued by the fucking practice that was across the hall. So then I looked into the practice that was across the hall, Advanced Behavior Health. They all used to be a group. They ended up suing each, like some lawsuits broke out that broke everybody up, right? Like cosign. So it broke everybody up. So Sussell then went across the hall. He, according to the I looked up their whole court, the court case. I read all the evidence. I read all the testimonies. I was like, I took my shit like, a bitch got a few shit as a lawyer if I wanted to do that. Because I got down and dirty. I knew everybody's motherfucking dirty laundry. I knew everything but they blood type, bitch. So look, they said that Sussell couldn't stay there or whatever. He had to leave. So he went across the hall. Dr. Christensen, who ended up, my dumbass at the time while I was working there, had hired Dr. Christensen to be my son's therapist. You know, because like I said, he has autism. So we needed to start behavioral therapy and shit like that. So I tried to be, I tried to finesse my situation. I don't want to have to keep calling out and picking my son up and going out to these doctor's appointments for him. So what we're going to do is hire the doctor next door. The school's like, I had set it up to where the school was 15 minutes from my crib, was 15 minutes from my job. So I hop on 295 real quick, go pick up my son, come back to work. I could still be on the clock because we had paid lunches while we had our doctor's appointment right next door with Dr. Christensen. Now, this is before the lawsuit. So when I actually was suing and I had to dig deep, I learned that Dr. Christensen and Dr. Sussell was together at Advanced Behavioral Health. And when that whole lawsuit broke, there were a lot of people that got dispersed. So Advanced Behavioral Health was still a functioning practice across the hall. Then you have Greater Washington Psychiatry and Counseling, which is the new name because Sussell couldn't practice under his license no more. So then Hafuna allowed him to practice under him. They renamed it Greater Washington Psychiatry and Counseling. Hafuna had nothing to do with the Advanced Behavioral Health shit. So let's keep that in mind. He's one of them. He looks like he's a Arab, but he's Egyptian. He's North African. But he allows Sussell to then come under his thing, and this is such a great story, so just follow me. Allow him to come under his or whatever, and yeah, work under him like a cosign, like Nikki said. So then Christensen is next door. So literally on the seventh floor at this, in this building, in the Maryland World Trade Center, the second building, on floor seven, Advanced Behavioral Health is across the hall, who has sued and won against Joshua Sussell, who was across the hall in Greater Washington Psychiatry and Counseling, underneath the guise of Hafuna Mental Health and Wellness. Because when I got my checks, Hafuna Mental Health and Wellness was the ones cutting my checks. So that's when I started being like, where is Sussell at and all of this? Because Sussell's supposed to be the head man in charge, but who is this Hafuna person? So I really started thinking about that. Then Christensen is literally next door, And all of them are in, like, these non-compete type situations from the court thing, right? All right. Cecil, during the lawsuit with ABH, had broken away and then went under Hafuna, right? But he was then, like, trying to hire people that were still working at ABH. He was trying to, like, bribe them with competitive salaries, bring them over to his, so, like, stealing their people. He got sued for that. So a lot of the people that worked at the place that I ended up working with came from ABH. They got bribed over there with competitive salaries. What they didn't realize was you went from out of the fire pan into the fire, because to go work underneath him, he was very, first of all, he's a Jew. Let's start there. And he's like one of them Jews that's like white, blue eyes, black hair, like Jew. His friend Toby, a Jew. Toby is who he had supposedly put over his billing and shit like that. And this whole time they had no HR department, guys. No HR department. I found this out when I sued. Like, where's my liaison? Where's my, you know, the person that's supposed to be here for me when shit ain't going right? All right. Hafuna was really quiet, never really spoke. We saw him every now and then. He came, like, maybe twice a week. But he never really said anything. Cecil, though, was very had sexual advances on people. Like, he would be smacking us on the ass. Oh, just call me Josh. Shit like that. There was sexual assault going on. There was lowballing in pay. You were hiring all of these women, bringing them over from ABH. These women had degrees and were working on degrees. Single moms, you know what I'm saying? All of us had children. Majority, maybe only one or two of us did not have kids. But you're hiring all these women that are single moms. At least one of the children is disabled. Some of the women had like 3 disabled kids, 7 kids with 4 of them disabled. Like, it was a pattern. So you hiring all these women, right, with the same type of demographics, social demographics. This is when my statistics start coming in, because, you know, I dug deep. So I'm looking at the statistics, and I'm seeing this, what they call and excuse my verbiage if I'm not pronouncing it correctly, because I'm kind of hyped right now. But if I'm not mistaken, it's like a disparament type statistic, where what I can see is the turnover rate of the company. How many black women are you hiring? How many black women are you firing? And within what time frame? Now, then what you do in math is look at that over, this is why you guys learn ratios and proportions and shit like that. Look at that over the course of like 10, 20 years. You can see the impact that this company's policies is having on a specific demographic. That's when I took that shit deep, okay? Low-key a Rosa Parks over here. So I'm just like, all right, these motherfuckers hired and fired, y'all, with me included. I'm sorry, with me not included. 17 single black moms and hired and fired them within a year and a half. 17 of us hired and fired within a year and a half. And this is before I came. When I came, I witnessed more people get fired, and I was just the one that stood up and was like, you got me fucked up. I was like, okay, you got me fucked up. I'm finna. So that's when I realized we didn't have like employee handbooks and shit. We didn't have no set of the rules. We had no understanding of what the rules were. And Spirit was like, they're doing that on purpose. Because if I don't tell you what the rules are and you break or you do something I don't like, I could tell you broke a policy and then I could punish you for it. And the punishment is going to be based on whatever fuck I want to say the punishment is. Because it's especially in Maryland, this is an at-will state. I could fire you just because I'm having a bad day today, and there's nothing you can do about it. Like, that's that at-will bullshit, right? Ha, but it does have loopholes. So, I ended up working there or whatever. Thought it was amazing, and it was it for what it for at the time that I received it. You know, you got to learn how to see sometimes how the bad things are still blessings when they show up. So, you know, at the time it's what I needed. But then when shit started getting revealed to me, I was like, know about this. So I had a coworker that had multiple sclerosis. I watched them bully her into quitting because she kept on having these doctor's appointments. Her ailment was exacerbating very fast. And I remember her coming to work, bleeding out of pads, wearing masks, like I said, she was bleeding out of her pads because I had to give her pads and help. And she had to put like sweaters around her back. She could barely breathe.
her MS was what had then grew, like it exacerbated so bad. She had over like 13 lesions, if I'm not mistaken, in her on her brain. She then was having some type of cancer or fibroids in the womb. So then that was caused, like, it was just exacerbating so fast. When I got hired there in October of 2017, what the fuck year? What year did I move here, John? It was 2018. When she got diagnosed, when I got hired, October 2018. She then got her diagnosis like maybe a week after my hire date. So I remember her coming to work being like, yo, they just told me I have multiple sclerosis. Mind you, look at how God worked. I had just transferred to this job from working at a job where I worked underneath a multiple sclerosis doctor. I worked for a neurologist for a long time, her and her husband. And I was a one-man band there. I knew how to do everything. I was cross-trained on everybody's job. So it was a very good experience, but I knew firsthand what the fuck was going on with multiple sclerosis, how to treat it, or how, you know, medically how they try to treat it, shit like that. So when I met her, and then she ended up telling me she had just got diagnosed like a week after me getting hired, immediately, I'm like, oh my God. So I didn't think it was a coincidence. I had another coworker whose son had like muscular dystrophy. I had another coworker who had just had a newborn. I had another coworker who was older than all of us, but they was picking on her, like wouldn't give her appropriate pay, you know, had her sit, like they just was real fucking shady. Let's just ball it up like that. They was shady as shit. They treated us like slaves, like fucking cattle. Okay. You weren't allowed to be sick. Your kids weren't allowed to be sick. In my case, how the fuck do I get a final warning and a write-up and get fired for my son having strep and a ruptured eardrum, ear infection? His left eardrum had ruptured. I remember sending a picture to everybody in the group chat on some shit like, whoa, like mother to mother, what do I do? Like my son's ear is bleeding. And they were like, you know, the manager, the white lady, she's like, yeah, you know, take him to the ER. So I'm like, all right, cool. So I'm out of work, right? This is on a Friday. Come back to work on a Monday. I had a final warning. Final. First of all, when did I get the first one, bitch? So I had a final warning or whatever. And she was like, you know, if there's any more schedule variances. Oh, that's what she did. She's like, yeah, we just came out with the handbook or whatever, which was my fault. And I'm trying not to bore y'all. That's why I'm like jumping around because I want y'all to get certain meat and potatoes. Because the story is pretty elaborate and it has a lot of details, but I don't want to go into that and then like tie your morning up. But the bottom line is they were shady, but I was time enough for them. So every time they tried to do some shit, I like was like, okay, but what about this? Okay, but what about this rule? Or what about this law? Like, that's wrong. No, you can't do that. They did not like me. You're not about to write me up for some rule you didn't tell me was a fucking rule. Like, are you crazy? So then I'm like, where's my employee handbook that I'm supposed to sign to say that I agree and understand and agree to the terms of my employment? Where that's at? They didn't have one. So then they made one. Because I was like, where that's at, bitch? So then they made one. Then when they made one, the rules made no sense. You have in here that I can't have more than 4 schedule variances, right? That I can't have more than 4 schedule variances in a 90-day period. But I have kids, and I have 3, and then I have myself. So what that means is, let me tell you what that means, because it kind of happened with Dallas by himself. This wasn't even my son with the cognitive disability. It was my son who was sick. He had diarrhea on like April 8th. So we coming up on the year of when all this happened. That's how, that looks like a juju don't play, you understand? It's the anniversary, bitches. But anyway, so Dallas on the 8th, I remember, had like it was like the first week of April, he had diarrhea and lethargy and shit like that. So I had called out of work like maybe 2 times, but they weren't in consecutive days. It was like spread out in a week, so like a Monday and a Thursday. Then the Thursday after that, I got off work, took him to urgent care. They was like, he has strep. He has acute strep throat and an ear infection. Then that night, Thursday night going into Friday morning when I was supposed to go to work, his eardrum ruptured. I had his dad here to keep him so I can go to work and everything. So I made my
accommodations, if you will. But when my baby ear was bleeding, I'm like, I'm not going to work. So then his father retarded. Like, he don't know what to do with this. So let's call it like it is. So I, like I'm saying, here, my baby, period. So that happened. And then, so if we count that, that's 3 days. Yeah. That Monday, then a Thursday, then the next day was the next week. It was that Friday. I got a letter saying this is a final warning. If you get one more, you get fired. And I was like, what fucking sense do that make? I have medical documentation. I also have text messages from you telling me to take them to the ER. So you gonna tell me to stay home and then write me up for it? What? So me and Megan, that's her name, that bitch, me and her had already been clashing. Me and her had already been on some shit, like because I was timing up for her. She was this new operations manager that got, she, when I got hired, she was leaving on maternity leave. Joyce was the old operations manager who hired me. Joyce loved me, love Joyce. She's a white lady, but Joyce, the reason they fired Joyce is because I dug deep. I started interviewing motherfuckers that got fired. I dug deep. So what was your experience like? Oh, that's what's going on behind the closed doors? I know everything. Joyce got fucking fired because Joyce wasn't in cahoots with the racist type of policies and things they were trying to implement. They were really bullying us. They were like, there was this one, the girl I told y'all passed away and her 3 sons that are disabled. I said, I want to open a trust fund and I still plan to. This brand blow up big enough, or not if, y'all said to stop saying that. When this brand blow up big enough, you know, I'll be able to fund, you know, those children like I wanted to. I want to be able to put in a trust fund or whatever, because their grandmother going to end up getting old and die too. So their mother is dead now. This colleague of mine is now deceased. But at the time when she was working there, you know, she was heavy set and had depression issues. They was these upper management, all white people, right? Only white people could be upper management. Upper management was doing shit like throwing staplers at her, locking her in closets with a phone, telling her to answer all the phone calls. But in like, I mean, treating her like shit. They treated us like shit. To work there, you know what? I'd have a great way to help y'all understand the climate of that job. Y'all seen Civil Brand? It was Civil Brand. That job was Civil Brand, with the sexual assault, with the racism, with the sexism. It was like Civil Brand. It was just like that. They treated her like shit. They treated me like shit. The only thing was a check. You can't pay me enough to make me sit there and let you fucking play with me. Ain't enough money in the world. I'm like, y'all okay with this shit? Nah. I saw how they was doing my friend Tracy, like I said, who had the multiple sclerosis. Nah. I watched her doctor write a letter talking about if she doesn't leave this job, she gonna die. And it ain't even gonna be because of the illness. Y'all, the stress in the workplace environment is exacerbating. They was like, she has the progression in multiple sclerosis of somebody who's had it for over 10 years without proper treatment. She caught it early. Like, the doctors caught it early, but it exacerbated as if they had never caught it in a whole decade. That's how crazy it was there. When I interviewed the girls that was working there before me, they was having strokes and seizures and shit, having to get carried away in the ambulance from the workplace environment. Like, they'd be at work and the toxicity in the air was so bad that they had, 2 girls had a stroke. A young girl and an older lady had a stroke from working there. That's how bad it was. So then you hire me. I come in there with my elekes, my spiritual practices, my crystals everywhere, roses on the desk. Y'all know me, jokey joke. Lovey love. You ain't got no lunch? All right, I'm buying you lunch. It was a family. We were a family when I came in that motherfucker. And they broke up my fucking family with their racism. They gonna put this big white bitch, and she a big white bitch too. They gonna put this big white bitch, I mean at least 315 pounds, in the goddamn seat of management with no real credentials and a past with opioid addiction. How the fuck you gonna be looking over a practice that writes the prescriptions for controlled substances when you yourself used to abuse them and it's public court record? So I ain't gossiping. Look it up on K-Search. It's right there. How the fuck she end up the manager? Over people like Miss LaAngel, who was overqualified. I mean, went to school, had experience in being a manager in other places, doing the billing. She was good with her numbers. Black lady, she didn't get promoted. You promote this bitch. And then when I got hired, she was leaving on maternity leave. Joyce was getting fired because Joyce wasn't with that shit. Joyce was like, I don't like what y'all doing them, doing these girls. Y'all kicked me out the meetings. She wasn't even allowed to go to the meetings. She was like, I'm supposed to be the operations manager. They're not letting me in there to even come up with the policies because I'm about, you know, righteousness. I'm about doing what's right, regardless of what the fuck our skin colors are. Joyce got hired from the outside, right? The manager that I'm telling you that I end up suing, she was a hire from the inside. So they got smart. They was like, I'm no longer going to hire a white lady from outside who don't understand the climate of the people here or the situation here. I'm a hire a girl, let her work low with the worker bees, and then hire and then promote her. So then she already understands the climate. She understands these girls. She knows these girls. And so it makes it easier. Then they had this black lady named Shay as the assistant manager who, let's keep it a stack because we on my platform, she was a porch nigga. She was, and literally what Joyce said is they put Shay in that position because they said that you're very loud all the time and it's people right next to you. There's no reason for you to be yelling at them. She, Shay or whatever, was black, right? So they said that it would make it easier for the policies to get passed to us, the black workers, if it was given to us by somebody that looked like us. They said she blended in with us. That was their exact words. And I'm sitting here like, I know you as motherfucking that. I know you that. You hired the Porsche nigga because you thought that was going to make me be on some, okay, I guess it's okay type bullshit just because she black too. I see through that shit. She going to do whatever the fuck you tell her to do because she a sellout. She want a fucking check. And so she gonna do everything but lick the bottom of your fucking feet to ensure that she got a check. I'm not that bitch. You gonna have to, you can take, and as you saw, they took the whole job and everything. You gonna see me again. You gonna feel me. You know what I'm saying? You gonna remember me. And I'm gonna pop back up. So it's not over with. It's not even over with. This shit just started. But anyway, get back to it. So, boom. They put Shay in this position or whatever so she can, like, pass down the policies or whatever to the black girls, right? All right. Joyce then wasn't allowed to talk, wasn't allowed to go into the meetings. Because, for instance, they came up with, and this was before I got hired. So I did my research and interviewed the girls that worked in the position that I then later filled. Over 17 of them, y'all. How did I get over 17 girls that I did not know to tell me their story? How did I get over 17 girls that I did not know that still had their documented emails after being fired for like 2 and 3 years, but still had the emails so they could send it to me? Documentation for court, exhibits for court. I'm taking the past and using it to help you understand the picture I'm painting about what happened to me. Those are called class action suits, but I didn't have like those really work for companies like Coca-Cola and shit like that, that hire big amounts of people where big amounts of people can sue at one time. It's a private practice. So, you know, it was only a group of like maybe 20 of us and that wasn't enough, but it was enough for them to still be called to the stand. And then what I was going to do is just break everybody off a couple thousand. You know what I'm saying? Thank you for your participation. And you know, that justice has been served. Let's move forward. But either way, you know, if you was involved in it, you was going to get a pension because that's just how I am. But, yeah, so long story short, the bitch, let's jump back to when I came to work. She gave me that final warning. I'm like, the fuck? So I'm like, make that make sense to me. I remember going to her office, like, make that make sense to me. This happened off just one kid. And I have medical documentation to prove that he was sick and contagious. This happened off just one kid. So imagine if this happened off with my child that is disabled, if he had an issue, or my daughter who's allowed to fucking get sick. What, her chances of being sick just get snatched from her because everybody else got sick too many times in a month? Are you fucking crazy? Then what about me? I'm allowed to have to take care of my fucking self. So you trying to tell me that I only get 4 days in a 3-month period to take care of my fucking family or to just fucking call out because I feel like it? I only get 4 days to do that? To take care of these kids? That shit don't make no fucking sense. I was like, make that make sense. I said, it's one thing to implement a policy, but to be a good leader, you have to implement a policy that actually works for your community of people. And the type of women you only hire single women. You only hire single mothers. You only hire single Black mothers with disabled kids. So what the fuck makes you think of the policy telling us that we can't have more than 4 scheduled variances, which doesn't mean calling out. It could be you being late. It could be anything. You could come in, like, literally the day that deemed me to get fired, I was a minute past the grace period. 1 minute. 1 minute. And they had gotten a photo because what made me late, people who live out here in the DMV know about Metro Access buses. A Metro Access bus had blocked me in my parking space. Took a picture of it. Oh, my phone wanna act like you wanna die. Everything when I start talking juicy, you wanna do that dumb shit. But anyway, plugged it up. Psych, you thought. But talking to my electronics like that, like you fucking thought. But anyway, a Metro Access bus had blocked me in. I couldn't get out of my car. So I took a picture and sent it to the management, like, hey guys, you know, like, this is what's going on. It's not that I'm late, you know, it's just that I can't move. Then when I still was speeding, parked, ran my ass up there, got there to clock in, and somebody was using my computer to check in a patient. Finally was able to check in the patient, and boom, 1 minute past, 1 minute past the grace period. But wait, there's more. I'm asking her to make it make sense. She's like, it doesn't have to make sense to you. Y'all don't have to like the rules. This is what they are because I said that's what they are. Yeah. Yeah. I was sitting there and then, you know me, my fiery ass. That Leo and me was like, bitch, who the fuck is you talking to? Bitch, who the fuck is you talking to? She was like, and I was like, what's the issue between me and you? Because yeah, I asked her, the fuck you got an issue with me? Because ever since she had come back from maternity leave as the office manager, all these changes had happened, but I had already established, you mind you, she was gone for like 3 months. I had already established my place in that job. So I had come in there knowing what I was doing, delegating responsibility, going through the mail, making sure shit was being taken care of these patients. You know, I started to see illegal shit happening. Like they was doing urinary drug screens. And they were doing illegal urinary drug screens. They were doing insurance fraud. I just came from working in a building. I know about balanced billing with government insurance. You ain't supposed to do that shit. They was out there. There was people who had balances. And they was like, yeah, you got to balance like $400. And I know because I ended up saying it. And then I caught myself. I'm checking a patient in. I'm like, yeah, you got a balance of like, it was like two something. And his mom, mind you, he was somewhat slow. His mom was with him. And she was like, no. She was like, we have such and such as a secondary. And with that as a secondary, you can't do that. I'm like, I know what she's talking about. But I'm like, let me look. So now I look, and I'm really combing through his thing. And I saw what I needed to see. And I said, if it's happening to him and he's cognitively disabled, it's happening to a lot of our other patients too. So I'm like, y'all going out here saying we take state insurance, but then still balance billing? Like, making them pay balances for something that the state waives? It was fucked up, y'all. And then when I dug deep, I realized why that type of shit was happening. Cecil had been sued in early 2019 for tax evasion by the state. And he had to pay back, like, over... How many grand was that? Don't quote me. So I'm going to give you a range because I don't want to misquote. But it was between 10 and 20 grand. I know he had to pay back state taxes to the state because he was evading them. And so what I then noticed he was doing was implementing all of these slick policies where people had to pay these extra fines. Like, for real, y'all, in order to get a prescription, you had to do a urinary drug screen. And I said, this doesn't make sense because some of these patients come here simply because, you know, they need somebody to talk to. They're not drug addicts. Not all of them are drug addicts. And we only had certain doctors who saw the addicts. So I'm like, and I'm CRISP certified. I know how to CRISP, you know, and make sure that people aren't drug shopping around with their doctors. You know, they'll hop from doctor to doctor. Like, I've been certified in that. So I'm like, why we don't implement CRISP and you hire somebody certified to run it, make sure that the prescriptions are being filled properly. Why are you charging them to pee in a cup every time that they sign their name in just to come in and say they had a bad day last week? That shit makes no sense. And this is why shit in healthcare be so expensive, because you got doctors that's like over overly sending out these tests and shit like that. That's not really needed because they trying to cash the fuck out. They doing some shady shit. I saw upcoding. I saw him literally pack an 8-hour schedule with almost 48 patients, right? But was only spending 5 minutes with them in the room, but was billing them as if he spent 30 minutes to an hour with them. That's fraud. It's insurance fraud. When I saw all of that, and they knew I seen something, they was like, oh, we got to get rid of this bitch. I just knew too much. And my thing is, everybody can get their coin, but get it righteously. Get it justfully. Don't be playing with people's health. Don't be fucking with people purposely making them sick. I seen them prescribing medications people did not need. Don't be in there. Once you fuck with somebody's mind, that's something that can never go back. You know, other cells and tissues can regrow, but that brain, when you fuck with certain neural pathways, they are fried, dried, and laid to the side until your ass is done. So it's like you can't just be coming out with these medications and giving people this shit for what? Because they got an imaginary friend or something. You can't just keep, like, fucking with them in their minds, because what ends up happening is they can't bounce back from that, and then they really are a patient. So I worked in the medical field for 11 years. Let me tell you, they're not creating cures. They're creating customers. So I got the fuck out of there because I couldn't stand by it. And when they would be like, well, what do you think? I'd be like, I think you should go get you a green card. Like, go get you a weed doctor. Go get you a holistic therapist. That's what I think. I used to tell them that shit. You know, I work here because I have to work here. But if you once you ask me for my personal opinion, meet me in a bathroom. I'm going to tell you. That was me. Give a fuck. Out here killing people for a check. Fucking crazy. And then blood on my hands because I work here. Nah. So, yeah. Always been a rah-rah type. So, yeah, all this was going on. Like, it was not just my issues. Like I said, it was the multiple sclerosis issues. The issues with the staff as a whole. Megan then came in there. She ain't had shit to say to me. Like, when she got hired, she had already heard about me. Because when she came in, before she came in, Joyce, like I said, was still the manager. Joyce had given me a raise. Because I kept, you know, pinpoints that I was sending the owners of the practice emails. Like, did y'all know that? Y'all need to be setting up credibility type things, checkpoints and checks and balances. And, you know, I'm letting them know, like, I've been in the game for a minute and I'm already seeing some real rookie mistakes. So I was sending them emails. They was changing some policies because Joyce was still in the rule. Joyce gave me a whole dollar raise off that shit, which was unheard of in that company. You understand what I'm saying? So then, boom. Joyce ends up getting booted because she wasn't with the shit. Megan comes in. Motherfucking Eveline. She was rude to me, y'all. She would purposely not speak to me in front of everybody. I'd be like, hey, you know, Grand Rising or whatever I say. She'd speak to everybody else. She'd be like this to me. Like that. In front of everybody. And everybody be like, God, what the fuck? And I'm like, I'm at work. So I'm like, did this bitch just shoe fly? Don't bother me. Do you know I would smack the fucking bitch? What? So I just like, I'd be like, I said hi. I got annoying like my kids. Like, bitch, I said hello. The fuck, you heard me? I'd be like, hello. And she'd be like, oh, hi, hi. Yeah. What's that? Yo, big polar bear looking ass, and you got the nerve to come in here. Back from maternity leave, coming here being rude. Then she gonna be like, I ended up calling the meeting. Let's sum it up. I ended up calling the meeting because I got tired of how she was treating me. I got tired of how she was treating my fucking staff. And I said my staff. My friends who were the staff. I got tired of that shit. So I was calling meetings. Like, I want a meeting with you, the porch nigga, and the person who cut my check, and the motherfucker that's hiding under his name because he can't get a fucking license of his own. I want to talk to all y'all motherfuckers. Y'all got me fucked up. So I was having meetings and shit. Like, you know, she when she came, she was writing me up. That's what it was. I had just gotten a raise. But then she came in and not even a week into her being there, y'all, I had a fucking 8-bullet write-up. A 8-bullet write-up. With everything from the dress code down to professionalism. But I had just gotten a raise for being the shit. So it didn't make sense. I'm like, oh, you're trying to establish your presence here. You recognize influential energy. I come in here and my shit rubbing off on people. They getting readings under the desk on lunch break and shit. You know, they into spirituality. You know what I'm saying? They and the ones that was Christians was still fucking with me. So it's like, you recognize this influential energy. You come in after this influential energy has already made her home. You know what I'm saying? I have my own desk and shit, my own side of everything. With, like I said, my crystals was everywhere. I had roses. It was just a zen-ass area in my shit. And I knew what I was doing. I knew my shit. I knew how to do my job well and still have a good time. I was a candy lady, too. I had a whole fucking drawer with everything you could think of, from Charleston shoes to Boston Bay-Bays. I was candy lady, okay? Badass kids in the lobby. You want a fruit cup? That was me. I was like little big mama in there. And they loved me, okay? Still love me. We still in contact. Even the doctors. I'm still in contact with some of the doctors. So, boom. The point I'm making is, you now the new operations manager, you come in and this is black girl that everybody fuck with. You like, oh no, I gotta, in my presentation in the courtroom, or in that first portion of the court hearing, I made a diagram of chattel slavery and compared it to the workplace. I compared it to that job. I had the different tiers of the triangle, with the bottom tier being the worker bees, the slaves. You had your porch nigga, you had your all white women, which in the slavery house is usually what? The madams of the home, the white women of the home. You seen Django, you know what I'm saying? Or your the porch niggas, or the women in the house that thought they were better than everybody that was outside the house, were brought in with the understanding of this. This was the true exchange. I will give you somewhat better conditions in exchange for your loyalty and allegiance and for you to betray your own on command. And that's the fuck Shay signed up to be. I never had no respect for a bitch like that, period. So my thing is, that was the thing. And then at the very top is usually Massa. And who was that? Joshua Sussell, the Jew. Who did he hire as his operations managers? Only white women. Shay was the only woman that has ever held the assistant operations manager position. Nobody else. Who did you have as your head of billing? Another Jew named Toby. Who did you have as your HR? Which there was no HR until I started complaining about it. I said, where the fuck is HR at? Where the fuck is my liaison? Because y'all got me fucked up. You come out with a goddamn employee handbook after I have to tell you to. And then in the employee handbook, you say, oh, if you have any issues with harassment or this, that, and the third, come to these people. But it's the people that's fucking harassing me. So who do I go? Who's above you? Where's the checks and balances at? You never put in there that I have a right to sue. I had to find that out on my own. You never, and you know who told me? One of my coworkers. When all that shit was going on with my son and them trying to fire me behind him having a fucking ruptured eardrum, she was like, son, that's illegal, bruh. She was like, Maryland has this thing where, you know, it's like a Family Care Act. She's like, yo, that's illegal, son. She like, you need to look into suing. A colleague told me that. So then I looked into suing. And then here we are. So I actually went through with it. It took me 2 tries or whatever. You know, the first time they turned me away, but that's because that's what I'm teaching in my course about etymology. And you learning that even in the coronavirus. Newsflash. If you want to get late fees and shit waived, call and say. It's code. Everything's algorithm, even in life. Even in everyday life. And I'm here to tell you, everything's algorithm. There's nothing demonic about algorithm. It's the understanding of linking of frequencies. So you have to say the right shit to get what you want. If you need an extension or you need some time because you lost your job or whatever, I've been affected by the coronavirus. All you got to say. Niggas have policies that are designed strictly for when they hear those keywords. But they're not going to be like, oh, we're giving out free months of rent. You got to call and be like, this is what it is. And then they'll do it. Same thing with court. When I went before the EEO the first time, I didn't use the right trigger words. I learned about trigger words. You got to say certain things that automatically turn on a switch in their brain and say, oh, this is a case. She said the word. She said the magic word. I got to pull out the documents now. When I learned that shit, I came back. Did it again on the day I got fired. Because at first, I had filed before I got fired. I filed before I got fired because of them harassing me. It was a lot of racial discrimination. I got picked on a lot. They was docking my pay without me knowing. Like, I would get paid. Y'all are loud! Sorry, my kids, all they water signs. They're all water. So when they be out there, all they want to do is argue and fight. I do not like that. Like, find something productive or play, or why can't motherfuckers be in harmony? Why y'all always bitching with each other? Like, water signs together, Pisces and Cancer, all day? That's what I hear all fucking day. But anyway, back to the story. Yeah, so with everything I'm telling y'all, now y'all see why a bitch had to go so hard. Like, you didn't just fuck with me. You fucked with the girls before me and the girls that's there after me. When I left, I'll never forget the text messages I was receiving. Like, we lost our voice. You was our voice. Like, some of them knew right from wrong, but couldn't stand up to the powers that be. I wasn't scared of that shit. And with having me there, they felt safe. I ain't there no more. It's like, yo, we out here by ourselves. So I'm like, you not. You know what I'm saying? Like, I still got you. You know what I'm saying? I'm still be there for you. I'm fighting this. I'm going to court. You just, when it's time, this is when, see, when revolutions come, you can't have people that's scary. I'm like, when it's time to be on a stand, or when discovery phase kicks in and they out here getting ready to start interviewing y'all, y'all can't then get scared. If your opponent is sitting in a room with you, looking you dead in your face while the authorities are asking you specific questions, you better fucking be steadfast, bruh. Don't let nothing that I have done be in vain. Don't be, oh, thank you so much. Oh my God, we treat me like this savior. But then when it's time to save yourself, your tail between your legs, and you sucking the other white man dick. No, no. When it's time to stand up, stand. Period. And it's not going to be comfortable. It's going to be scary. Do it. And if you can't do it, you can't fuck with me. Get the fuck away from here. I'll kill you. That's that Nat Turner shit coming out. Fuck on now. But I have to get rid of your ass. You've canceled in the black community. But yeah, like, I went a whole wide, well, the whole way, y'all. I did statistics. I did the math on it. I then took their documents, because when they gave their position statement, they submitted documents that weren't real. Like I said, their disciplinary system was bullshit because they made up rules as they went along. I was just the one to say, you ain't finna do that. I ain't know that was a rule, so I can't be held accountable for breaking it. Oh, I can't wear Uggs in the winter? I didn't know that. I didn't know. Oh, I can't wear open toe, a peep toe in the summer, and it's fucking 98 degrees out here? Oh, I didn't fucking know that. Fucking tell me. What is my dress code? I'm supposed to know that. There's no orientation when you get hired. You just throw us in there and make us start working. Most of the girls are not trained, so they didn't know what they was fucking doing. So then you fired them for that. Oh, incompetency. But did you train her? Like, that type of shit was going on. And I pulled the plug on it. Like, you firing people you never trained. You firing people without a proper documentation to show that, okay, we tried to do everything. We did a performance improvement plan. We did this, we did that. It just isn't a good fit. We have to let her go. You don't even have the files to justify all the women before me that got hired and fired. 17, over 17 in a year and a half. That's a lot of women, y'all. That's a lot of black single moms coming and going like a revolving fucking door. But who are the people that stay in place? The Porsche nigga. She stays right where she's at. She was one of the people from ABH that came over from that other lawsuit. She came over there. You know what I'm saying? When they start threatening her, he gave her a position. And yeah, that was that. And when I say he gave her a position, I ain't talking about he was being her friend. This is what I need for you to do. One of the policies that they had, one of the reasons they made Joyce leave. They fired Joyce, the white lady that they hired from the outside. They had put in this cell phone policy where in the policy it says that it only affects the subordinates, which are only black. You gotta look at it you gotta see past the words that's on the document. It was like, this only affects the subordinates. But when you looked at it, only the subordinates are all the black women. It doesn't affect upper management, which were the white women. And it said that, or the white man, and it said that at will, anytime that they want, they have the right to take the phone, your cell phone, and go through it. Go through your email. Go through your text messages. Just to and your social media to make sure that you're not participating in workplace gossip. Because he was paranoid because the people that he had hired for his practice came over from the old practice that was suing him. So he was scared that they were being moles and working under him for the to help ABH win the lawsuit. So then he was doing this thing like, let me go around and go through y'all phones. If I see anything that's suspicious or any type of conversation held during company hours, then you're fired. If I see you at your lunch break eating with people that worked across the hall, mind you, these are people they were friends with. They all worked together. So they go over there for a higher pay. And now they split up from their friend, ABH over here, they over here. They can't be friends no more. Get caught being friends. What I didn't realize until I went to sue them was that my best friend at the time, she's not my friend no more. I don't know what happened. It's like after that whole lawsuit and shit, she kind of just fell off. Like, I would say like September when that whole rape thing happened to me, she just stopped being my friend. And I don't know why to this day. I didn't do nothing. Didn't do nothing to her. We never had a falling out. I don't know why to this day. And it's one of them things that's just like, you got to be okay with, you know, other people cutting themselves off from you. Shit, I'm cool with it. You served your purpose. What I'm getting at is when I became friends with her, she worked for Dr. Christensen. She worked for Dr. Christensen. I worked for Dr. Sussell. Mind you, I just told you at the time I didn't notice, but I just told you Dr. Christensen and Dr. Sussell was in a lawsuit against each other. Right? They're competing psychiatrists. I'm best friends at the time with his lead receptionist, and I'm the lead receptionist over on my side. We besties. So then it's like, I realized afterwards that, did I do a reading on it? Oh, Teresa, we'll get there in a second, baby. But, did I do a reading on it? Did Madam Feminaki do a reading on it? You know damn well I did. But we're going to get to that in a second. So, not on the friendship, though, because I don't waste my time. I don't even waste my ancestors' time on shit that really don't matter. It don't matter. You don't want to be my fucking friend no more. Bye. Give a fuck. And just when she left, all y'all came. The fuck, I got a lot of other people that I'm connected to and I'm helping and that give me love and I give love back. And it's an actual I'm stuttering and shit. We reciprocating. Reciprocate. Tip-a-tat on the tip-a-tat. But, you know, motherfuckers is linking. We connecting this shit. I got more love being me, doing me now, than I did in, you know, thinking I had a friend. So you left, and I started seeing her posting shit with, you know, some of the coworkers and shit. They going out. So you seeing my text messages. You seeing my DMs. Y'all going on girls' nights out. You used to invite me. I'm not invited no more. I was like, oh, okay, boo. I'm a fucking good at shit anyway. But, you know, like I said, one left and over 300 came. You know, I take the friend or the word friend. I'm using it loosely right now. You know, obviously there's levels to intimacy. But shit, we at the threshold. I call my page the threshold. You know, anybody that fuck with me, you know, fuck with me genuinely. And it's not even a thing of like, oh, I'm following her because she a baddie and I like all her pictures and she just looks so good. You know, we got girls that we follow because they just look good. I'm blessed to I'm blessed to know how to cut that on and to be able to be like this and people still fuck with me. So my connectivity isn't even based on things that are superficial. It's all energy, baby. And that's all I ever wanted to be. So, you know, that to me is more of an honest friendship than whatever the fuck I thought me and her had. So she could go right on. She could go right the fuck on. Because you can't go where I'm going. And I wanted to take you with me. But you can't go. You got off the bus. And the bus is still going. And we cannot turn around. So, see you at the top. See you at the top. But anyway, what I'm getting at is, yeah, me and her end up being friends. I didn't realize till during the lawsuit that actually was one of the things that made them want to get me out of there was because I was a patient of a rival doctor that they were in a lawsuit against.